So again, as always, I preface my reflection with words of congratulations to you, David and Cesar, for your response to the movement of the Holy Spirit, this yes you are making to the call you have understood and the Church has affirmed in your lives. And also congratulations to your wives and your families on this day that is so filled with joy for them. And to all of you who have accompanied these two men to this hour in their journey of faith, I think particularly of the parish communities represented by the priests who have come here today as well, all of you really, and particularly my thanks to the formation team and the diaconate community for having assisted you in coming to this moment of accepting your consecration as deacons. Some of you are veterans to our celebrations here in the cathedral, and so you can probably guess what comes next, which is my remark, and it's important to remember it, that the liturgy is always the action of Jesus Christ. Yes, the people of God, but as members of Christ our head. In the sacred liturgy, what's going on in heaven at the right hand of the Father, even at this very hour since the Ascension, becomes present in our midst, in the Church, through the sacred signs and words that make up the sacred liturgy. And so that's why we listen to Scripture when we celebrate the acts of the liturgy, because we need to hear what Jesus thinks and says in his word, so that we understand what he's doing in his actions. No one knows better or can understand to some degree the depths of the workings of Christ except those who hear the word of Christ and understand. It is Christ who ordains these two men as deacons today. And so we have the texts that are appointed for our hearing so that we can listen to what Christ understands that he himself is about to do. And that's important for us in order to fulfill our role in the liturgy of giving God praise and thanks, because it always is right for when God acts, for him to be praised and thanked. His works merit that. As we say in one of the prefaces, it is to our salvation, for our saving status, that we give God praise and thanks. And so I would like then to reflect on the readings in order to help you with your praise and thanksgiving. And then I will read the instruction from the liturgy book to further help us understand what Jesus is about to do. So first of all, from the Acts, the reading we heard second today, it reminds us that the diaconate is established by the apostles themselves. I didn't make this up, you didn't make it up, an ecumenical council didn't make it up. The apostles established the diaconate under the impulse of the Holy Spirit. And so what we do today is not in imitation of or like or a reminder of what we heard about in the Acts reading. It is the same thing. The Church here in Southeast Michigan lives the very same life as the original Church in Jerusalem. We are an organic continuation of that church life. And for that, we certainly give God praise and thanks. And we give God praise and thanks that he has called these two men to be co-workers with the priestly orders in our local church, with us bishops and with our presbyterate, to assist us as Steve and Nicanor and the others of the seven assisted the 12 apostles in Jerusalem. Not like that, but the same. That's very important for us to understand. The reading from Jeremiah is very important to us and for our celebration of this ordination liturgy because the prophet points out to us that while these two men become servants within the organization of the church, clerics, churchmen, this is not a mere function, but it's very personal. The prophet Jeremiah reminds us that what happens in the ordination is a total consecration of these men to their mission and ministry. Their whole self becomes dedicated to their diaconal service. It's a very intimate kind of consecration. You heard God say in the reading, "Before you were born, I consecrated you, I dedicated you, I destined you." Think of that. Before you were born, when God only was thinking about your existence, he had in mind this day, giving you existence and then giving you existence, faith in Christ, so that he could bring you to this moment. And all of us, and you, I'm certain, brothers, like the prophet, say, "Ah, Lord, I'm too something." Maybe you're not too young anymore, I don't know about that. But I'm too something, it's too hard, too difficult. And the Lord says to you what he said to the prophet, "I know better. I know that I can make you better. Say not, I am too young, too whatever. I will make you a light to the nations." And then, and probably most importantly for us to understand what's happening so that we can give praise and thanks, we have this fundamental saying of our Lord Jesus in the gospel. "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." You remember, and we didn't hear it in the reading today, but this pronouncement of our Lord, this solemn pronouncement, comes just after the apostles had been squabbling about who's the greatest in their number. And he chides them about their way of thinking regarding service, and then delivers the solemn pronouncement I have just re-articulated for you. And in doing that, our Lord actually redefines what it means to be of service within the church. That service is not about making stuff happen ultimately. It's not about accumulating good results for other people. It's not essentially about making the community better, though it does all of those things. But service is not about stuff. Service in the church, as our Lord has redefined it, is always about the outpouring of oneself. This is the most important measure of authentic Christian service. Christ is the measure, insofar as he poured out his life's blood for those to whom were given to him to serve for their salvation. And so it makes sense that the first of the martyrs in the Jerusalem church was a deacon who poured out his blood by being stoned to death in witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. So Christ as an agent today making you deacons, servants in the church, actually also transforms you and cannot do anything other than, given that you become icons of service, cannot do anything other than call you to this level of service. That in whatever you do, whatever your ministry turns out to be, it can never not be about the gift of yourself to those whom you serve. I will say a little bit more about this later, but it seems to me this is one of the reasons it makes sense that in the mind of the church, at the holy table, the altar, it is particularly the role of the deacon to be ministered to the chalice. because it is within the chalice by the descent of the Holy Spirit that wine becomes the love of Jesus Christ poured out. Poured out. And so rightly do deacons who, as icons of Christ the servant, handle the chalice and be the ministers of the chalice within the Christian assembly. After I finish my remarks, I will read the instruction regarding the nature of the diaconate that's in the liturgical book for this ceremony, the pontifical. And you will hear, just to give you a preview, it talks about the three forms of diaconal service: the service of charity, the service of word and catechesis, and Eucharistic service at the altar, which encompasses all the forms of deacon's liturgical service. But I would remind you that these are not three discrete pieces, but they go together. They're like angles of a triangle. Without one, the others fall apart. They belong together. Because in all of them, in works of charity, in the service of the word, and in the service of the liturgy, the deacon is always an icon of Christ the service. So then, remember, always live the precious blood that you handle, brothers, and teach that same lesson to all those you serve.